Another very important category of plants, that is bryophytes. All right, so after the algae, the next form of plants which are a little advanced than the algae are the bryophytes. So in this section you will see various features which are not present in the algae, certain advanced features. All right, so let us start with the general characteristics of bryophytes. First of all, bryophytes, they are found commonly in damp, humid or shady areas. Okay, they are not able to tolerate very high light intensity, that's why are mostly found in shady areas. All right, and that's why they are also known as sciophytes. Plants which grows in shady areas are called sciophytes. All right, now they are mostly small and seldom reach great heights. So just after algae, the bryophytes being the first terrestrial plants, okay, they are found in terrestrial habitat. But then they, suddenly cannot be, very well advanced. Rather, they are very small and, they would not reach a great length or height. Rather, also they would grow in cluster. It's not that one bryophyte being here, another being there, no. They usually grow together in the form of carpet on the soil, okay. Next. They are called amphibians of the plant kingdom. This is very, very, very important. Bryophytes are called amphibians of the plant kingdom. That's because they are found in the terrestrial habitat, in the land, fine. But then for their sexual reproduction, they are completely dependent on the presence of water. So just like amphibians, they will be found in the land, but for sexual reproduction, they have to require water. Just like that, bryophytes will behave. Hence, they are amphibians of the plant kingdom. Plant body is thallus-like and may be prostrate and erect. They lack true root stem or leaves but possesses root-like, stem-like and leaf-like structures. Now this is very important. See, algae are thalloid, isn't it? Means the plant body is not differentiated into root, stem and leaf. Bryophytes are also the same. They don't have true root, true stem or true leaves, but they are not as simple as just like in case of algae as well. Their thallus is much more differentiated than the algae. So they have root-like structures called rhizoids, okay? They have stem-like structures. Likewise, they also have leaf-like appendages, okay? Now, plant body remains attached to the substratum by the help of rhizoids. Just like I told you, they have root-like rhizoids, which can be unicellular or multicellular, okay? Now, vascular tissues are absent. Of course, from the chart that I have provided you before that tracheophytes are the plants which possesses vascular tissues and they are pteridophytes, gymnosperms and angiosperms, isn't it? Bryophytes, they don't possess vascular tissues, xylem and phloem. Mostly being smaller in height, the bryophytes, for them, the conduction of water occurs from one cell to another. Cell to cell movement of or conduction of materials takes place within the plant body. Now, dominant phase or main plant body is free-living gametophyte and the sporophyte is born on it. Now, if we talk about the main plant body here, just like in algae, the main plant body was haploid, isn't it? Similarly, in bryophytes also, main plant body is haploid. So that means the gametophytic plant body is the main plant body. It is free-living, means it can photosynthesize by itself and it is not dependent on any other organism for food. It can manufacture its own food by itself. But the sporophyte, that means the diploid plant body, it is going to be born over the gametophyte and it is going to be dependent on the gametophyte for food. So we can say that in the bryophytes, the sporophytic plant body, the diploid plant body, acts like a parasite on the gametophyte because it will absorb food or nourishment from the gametophyte throughout its life cycle. Understood? So main plant body is gametophytic, free living, it can photosynthesize and manufacture its own food, whereas the dependent plant is the sporophyte. Diploid plant body is dependent on the gametophyte and will keep on acting or absorbing food or nourishment from the gametophyte, acting like a parasite. All right, now Gametophyte is haploid and generates gametes by mitosis, hence called gametophyte. Why is it called gametophyte after all? It's called gametophyte. Phyta means plant and gamete. So it is a plant which will bear the gametes. That's why we call it gametophyte. But the gametophytic plant body being haploid, it will produce gametes by mitosis. Do remember, a diploid organism will produce gametes by meiosis, but a haploid organism will produce gametes by mitosis. Alright? Now, the sex organs of bryophytes are multicellular and jacketed. Like in algae, the sex organs were unicellular and non-jacketed. Here, it is advanced. It is multicellular and jacketed. Now, the male sex organ is called antheridium and produces male gametes called antherozoites, whereas the female sex organ is called archegonium and it produces female gametes called egg. Okay, so male sex organ is antheridium, produces the male gamete which is called antherozoid, whereas the female sex organ is archegonium and it produces the female gamete, that is egg. Okay, understood this? Now, let us look at the diagram for antheridia and archegonia. Alright? So, see here. For antheridia, you can look at this diagram. Here, the structure consists of a stalk and a head. Okay? So, this is the body of the antheridia. The whole body remains surrounded by a sterile layer of cells called the jacket. Alright? And within that jacket remains protected the cells, the specialized cells which are meant for producing gametes called androcytes or androcyte mother cells. They will undergo mitosis and give rise to the gametes. That is called the male gamete, antherozoid. Look at the diagram of antherozoid. The antherozoids are like coil structure. They are going to be coiled and they possess two flagella. Because they possess two flagella, that's why the male gametes are motile. Alright? Now, moving to the archegonia. The archegonia, it consists of, like the body is going to be flask shaped and it consists of two parts. The neck, the narrow part is the neck, and at the base we have a rounded or globular venter, neck and a venter. The whole body remains surrounded by sterile jacket. As you can see, the whole thing is surrounded by sterile jacket, and in the neck there remains certain like linearly arranged cells. All these cells together makes up the neck canal cells or NCC. Alright? Only the last cell present in the neck, one last cell present in the neck, that's called the ventral canal cell or VCC. Alright? Inside the venter remains the main gamete, that is the egg or the female gamete. Female gamete is large and non-motile. Alright? So understood the structure of the male and the female sex organs? Alright? This is antheridia. It produces the male gamete antherozoid. This is archegonia. It produces the female gamete egg. Alright? Clear? Do remember here, be it the antheridium or archegonium, each and every cell present in this multicellular, sex organs, each and every cell will be haploid. Alright? Now, so water is required. I have told you already, they are amphibians of the plant kingdom because they require water for sexual reproduction. Now see, water is required for swimming of antherozoids to archegonia. So basically, when the antheridium will liberate the male gametes, that is antherozoid, the antherozoid being motile, it has to reach out to the archegonia, isn't it? So how will it swim? How will it reach out to the archegonia? For swimming, it would require water, isn't it? So that's why water is absolutely necessary for the sexual reproduction to take place. Otherwise, it is not possible. Fine? So the antherozoids will swim and reach the archegonia in the film of water or moisture that's present in the air. That's why water is absolutely required, and also bryophytes can be only found in moist and shady areas, not in dry habitats. Alright? Now, fertilization produces zygote, that is the two-end diploid structure, which is formed inside the archegonial venter. Zygote undergoes continuous mitosis, forming the embryo. Now see, once the antherozoid reaches out to the archegonia, okay, finally, when the antherozoids are released and they are swimming and reaching out to the archegonia, these cover cells of the archegonia, they would break and allow the antherozoid to reach inside. Once it reaches inside and fuses with the egg, fertilization has occurred, and what has been produced inside the archegonial venter is a diploid zygote. Okay, now just like in algae you have seen, the zygote immediately will undergo meiosis and give rise to a haploid state again, isn't it? Haploid spores. But if you remember, bryophytes are embryophytes, isn't it? So here the zygote will now continuously undergo mitosis and will give rise to an embryo. Okay, so they are the first embryophytes. Bryophytes are the first embryophytes. Do remember that. Now, the embryo develops into a sporophyte. Now, eventually the embryo will continuously keep on dividing mitotically and will give rise to another plant body. Okay, and this plant body is the diploid plant body, which we call as sporophyte. All right. Now, sporophyte consists of three parts: foot, seta, and capsule. The sporophyte is dependent on the gametophyte for its nourishment. So, as soon as the embryo is developed, embryo will grow up to become the diploid sporophytic plant body consisting of three parts: foot, seta, and capsule. And this plant body will remain attached to the gametophyte throughout its life cycle, and it will keep on taking nourishment from the gametophyte. Understood? Now, inside the capsule, there will be some specialized cells called spore mother cells, which will now undergo meiosis. Eventually, will undergo meiosis to produce haploid spores. So now again, the haploid phase or the gametophytic phase, it is going to come back. Okay, alternation of generation, isn't it? First we started with a gametophytic plant body, then we went for a sporophytic plant body. Now see how the gametophytic plant body will get back. Okay, how it alternates now. See, inside the capsule, spore mother cells, these are diploid spore mother cells, they will undergo meiosis and give rise to haploid spores. And all the spores of bryophytes are similar. They will produce only one type of spore. Hence, they are homosporous. Okay? In case a plant produces two different types of spores, they are called heterosporous. But bryophytes are homosporous. Alright? Now, as the capsule shakes due to wind, the spores are released, which then germinates immediately after falling on a suitable substratum. Now finally, when this haploid spores will come out of the capsule, they will fall on a moist soil, they will germinate, and they will give rise to a haploid gametophytic plant body. Okay, but then there is an important fact for you to remember here. See, the spores germinate either directly into a thalloid gametophyte in case of liver oats, and if or else it will grow through a filamentous stage called protonema in Moses. See now, you should remember here that the bryophytes can be of two types again. They have two subcategories again. One is a simple bryophyte, that is the liver oats, and the advanced bryophytes, that is another category, we call them Moses. In case of the liver oats, these spores, haploid spores, once they come out of the capsule, they will immediately fall onto the moist soil and give rise to a gametophytic plant body. Okay, no problem in that. But for Moses, what happens is, as soon as the spores will fall on the moist soil, it will directly not give rise to a gametophyte. It will first give rise to an intermediate stage called protonema stage. And once protonema stage will, you know, grow and it will, spread in the soil, and eventually from the protonema, what will arise is the gametophyte. So for the Moses or advanced bryophytes, we have three stages: spores germinating first into protonema, protonema then giving rise to the gametophyte. For liver oats, spores, they are germinating directly into gametophyte. That's the major difference between liver oats and Moses. In case of liverworts, protonema stage is absent, spore is directly giving rise to gametophyte. Whereas in case of Moses, first the spores will germinate into protonema. Protonema is going to give rise to a gametophyte. That's the major difference. All right. And the last thing is that, see, this is the sexual reproduction that we have discussed in bryophytes, and that's what mostly will occur. But then there is vegetative reproduction found in bryophytes as well. Vegetative reproduction occurs by fragmentation, budding, or gemmy formation. It's a very important thing we'll discuss under liverworts. And asexual spore or mitospore formation is absent. All right. So that's all regarding the entire general characteristics of the bryophytes. Here you have got to know how eventually the bryophytes will possess a haploid plan body, the gametophytic plan body, which will not have any specific true root, stem or leaf, rather root-like rhizoids, stem-like structure and leaf-like appendages. Eventually, as the gametophyte will grow, it will give rise to multicellular and jacketed sex organs. The sex organs are very distinct morphologically. The male sex organ is antheridium, producing the male gametes, that is the antherozoids, and the female sex organ is archegonium. It produces the egg. Alright. At last, in the presence of water, the antherozoids will be able to swim and reach out to the archegonia, and finally fertilization will take place inside the venta. Okay, giving rise to a diploid zygote. Now the zygote immediately won't undergo meiosis like the algae here. Rather, the zygote will now start undergoing continuous cell division by mitosis, giving rise to an embryo. The embryo eventually will give rise to the diploid plan body, the sporophyte or the sporophytic plan body, which consists of three parts, the foot, seta and capsule. Inside the capsule, eventually, some spatialized diploid cells called spore mother cells will undergo meiosis and will give rise to certain haploid spores. As the spores are released outside the capsule, in case of liverworts, okay, the primitive bryophytes or simple bryophytes, the spores will fall into the soil and will immediately give rise to a gametophyte. But in case of advanced bryophytes or Moses, the spores will first germinate into protonema, and then from protonema it will give rise to gametophyte. So that's how alternation of generation will be maintained in the bryophytes. So that's all regarding the entire life cycle of bryophytes. I hope all of you are clear about it. Alright, so next let's see the types of bryophytes in details.